Australia vowing to provide nearly $74 million in assistance package to war-torn Ukraine. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese says the package will include military and special operations vehicles. But he clarifies the assistance has been prepared even before the uprising of the Wagner Group. Australia is also set to extend duty-free access for imported goods from Ukraine to support its trade opportunities.
This additional support will make a real difference, helping the Ukrainian people who continue to show great courage in the face of Russia's illegal, unprovoked, and immoral war. It is sobering that 16 months on from Russia's invasion, its brutal conflict continues.
What is at issue in Ukraine today is the sanctity of the global rules-based order. And it is very important that Australians understand that this engages our national interest. And we will stand with Ukraine for as long as it takes for Ukraine to resolve this conflict on their terms.
On the front lines of Ukraine's counter-offensive, soldiers are fighting fiercely village by village in what has become a wasteland of battle and violence. This report brings us to the scene of a newly recaptured village in eastern Ukraine.
Right now, we are taking shelter here in the combat zone in eastern Ukraine.
We came here today to get a first-hand look at Ukraine's counter-offensive and speak to the soldiers who are fighting in this war. This village, Storozheva, like several others, was recently retaken by Ukrainian forces. The soldiers here are saying that the fighting in this area is particularly complex because Russian forces have literally dug in, building a network of deep trenches to fight from. From this point, we can hear the battle raging around us and see that the fighting on this block was recent and fierce. Russian forces left behind food, supplies, and even some of the bodies of their fallen. The village itself is virtually a wasteland. It is completely abandoned and destroyed. A flag on top of a burnt-out grocery signifies Ukraine's victory.
Soldiers here say their goal is to recapture all of Ukraine. But here in the combat zone, they also talk about future goals like going home, getting married, jobs, and the end of this war. Reporting from Storozheva, Ukraine, Heather Murdoch, VOA News.
Over now to Russia. Following a recent rebellion by the Wagner Group, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says the unprecedented challenge to Russian President Vladimir Putin may have exposed fresh cracks on the strength of his leadership. Blinken believes the threat is not yet over and it could take weeks or months to play out. He adds the turmoil could affect Russia's capabilities in Ukraine.
So I think this is clearly, we see cracks emerging. Where they go, if anywhere, when they get there, very hard to say. I don't want to speculate on it, but I don't think we've seen the final act. There's been a lot of focus on making sure that the Ukrainians have what they need to be as successful as possible on the ground, and we'll see how that unfolds over the coming weeks and even coming months. But again, to the extent this presents a distraction, a loss of focus for the Russians, that may help the Ukrainians on the battlefield.
A deal brokered by Belarusian President Alexander Lukashenko enabled Wagner's chief to move to Belarus in return for his group's safety, avoiding bloodshed. For an analyst, it's still too early for Putin to remove the Wagner leader, with its forces stationed in other countries as well.
I think that Putin might not try to get rid of Prigozhin straight away because those loose ends need to be tied up and somebody will have to assume command of his troops in Africa. So the part of the troops that are in Russia, they might be sent to Ukraine again, and those who are in Africa and Syria will need a leader. And the problem would be to find a credible leader, somebody to replace Prigozhin and somebody to whom these people will listen. This is why killing Prigozhin straight away wouldn't have favored Putin in the long term because of other operations in other locations. So maybe just for those purposes, Prigozhin will be kept so that he can control the troops until a better alternative comes up.
China expressing support for Russia's efforts to restore national stability. Russia's Deputy Foreign Minister Andrei Rudenko held talks in Beijing on international issues Sunday, following the most serious challenge to Putin's grip on power since Russia invaded Ukraine in February 2022. Russia's foreign ministry says China views the recent escalation in tensions as Russia's internal affair. It was unclear when Rudenko arrived in Beijing or whether his visit to the key Russian ally was in response to the apparent rebellion. A sustainability expert welcomes the proposal to ease the debt burden on countries most vulnerable to climate change. Angelo Kairos de la Cruz of the Institute for Climate and Sustainable Cities says the proposal aligns with the stance of the vulnerable 20 group of finance ministers, of which the Philippines is a member. He says the V20 nations have already incurred at least $525 billion of climate-induced damages, while servicing at least $435 billion in debt payments by 2028. But De La Cruz warns easing the debt payments should not replace climate financing and legislation.
For ICSC, and I think I also speak for the V20, is that we don't have to choose. Climate action, climate financing, loss and damage financing, which is very much needed, including debt relief, and how we restructure our debt relief approaches. All of them are part of the same ecosystem that developing countries have to own, have to have a lot of agency in, so that development and climate action can happen at the same time. Mm. And it can, simply because climate action, whether it's adaptation, whether it's mitigation, whether it's loss and damage, contribute to sustainable development, particularly in developing countries.
Canadian authorities opened an investigation into the implosion of a tourist submersible that killed all five people aboard while diving to the century-old wreck of the Titanic. More in this report.
What started as an adventure to the bottom of the ocean to examine the rotting remains of the Titanic ended in disaster last week off the coast of Newfoundland, Canada. All five people aboard undersea exploration company Oceangate Expedition's Titan submersible craft died when the vessel imploded. Canadian investigators are trying to determine what led to the disaster.
Typically, our investigations can take 18 months to 2 years. We obviously try and do them quicker because we know everybody wants answers, particularly the family, the public, etc. But we need to take the time. With respect to how far we will go, that remains to be seen as we gather information. So it's still too early to tell.
Authorities say fragments near the Titanic are the remains of the Titan. In a 2018 lawsuit, Oceangate's former director of marine operations described the company's testing and certification as insufficient and said that would subject passengers to potential extreme danger, according to PBS. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police, or RCMP, say an investigation is looking into the matter.
A team of investigators has been established with the sole purpose of answering the question of whether or not a full investigation by the RCMP is warranted. Such an investigation will proceed only if our examination of the circumstances indicate criminal, federal, or provincial laws may possibly have been broken.
Titan's operation in international waters meant it could skirt safety regulations and standards for things like hull construction. The Associated Press reports late Oceangate Expedition CEO and Titan pilot Stockton Rush had said he didn't want to be bogged down by such standards. Canada's Transportation Safety Board, or TSB, will investigate the role of icebreaker and mothership, the Polar Prince, which carried the Titan out to sea. The TSB says it's been speaking with those who traveled on board, but may be limited in what it can share with the public. Under Canadian law, says TSB Chair Kathy Fox, voice recordings and witness statements are protected. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
The U.S. Coast Guard has also launched its own probe into the undersea implosion of the tourist submersible Titan. The Coast Guard's chief investigator says the findings of its Marine Board investigation will be shared with international groups to help improve the safety framework for submersible operations.
During the course of the MBI, the board will first and primarily work to determine the cause of this Marine casualty and the five associated deaths. The MBI, however, is also responsible for accountability aspects of the incident, and it can make recommendations to the proper authorities to pursue civil or criminal sanctions as necessary.
Pride Month was also celebrated across the world. Bubbles filled the sky and cheers rang through the streets of Toronto as thousands of allies and members of the LGBTQIA community participated in Canada's largest Pride Parade. Meanwhile, rainbow flags waved in the streets of Chile during the annual Pride Parade. While the participants are celebrating Congress's approval of equal marriage rights to same-sex couples, they also demanded an update on a bill providing measures against gender discrimination. Over in the U.S., Pride Month was celebrated with displays of resistance amid growing conservative moves to restrict LGBTQ rights.
It's important that we find our community and we stick together and we build it and we get stronger. And being here, like, it feels amazing to, like, be around people who are really fighting for the same thing. And I know times are hard and scary and things are really messed up right now. All we can do is keep loving.
Our community's under attack and we need allies, we need the whole community to show up to advocate.